In the last video, I described the conversion of pyruvate to acetyl-CoA. In this video, I will talk about oxidation of the two acetyl carbons of acetyl-CoA to carbon dioxide in the citric acid cycle. The reactions of the citric acid cycle are shown here. You do not need to memorize them, but I will go through them briefly so that you have a sense of what's going on. The two carbons of the acetyl group of acetyl-CoA are transferred to a four-carbon molecule called oxaloacetate to make the six-carbon molecule citrate. It's this molecule that gives its name to the cycle. After a rearrangement, one carbon is oxidized and released as CO2. The electrons are transferred to NAD+ to make NADH, and we're left with a five-carbon molecule. Then a similar reaction happens again, oxidizing another carbon to CO2, and producing NADH. And we're left with a four-carbon succinyl unit attached to our old friend coenzyme A through a thioester linkage. When this linkage is broken to produce free succinate, enough energy is released to produce a GTP molecule, which is an ATP equivalent. The last three reactions of the cycle include two oxidation reactions in which electrons are removed from carbon and used to make QH2 and NADH. You can refer back to a previous video for an introduction to the electron carrier coenzyme Q. The oxaloacetate produced is ready to pick up two carbons from acetyl-CoA, and the cycle can start again. Now, many of these reactions are near equilibrium, but three of them are irreversible. For these irreversible steps, no alternate reactions exist that accomplish the so-called reverse or backwards processes. So what that means is that the cycle is irreversible. The complete cycle can turn in only one direction, the direction shown. The net reaction for the citric acid cycle is shown here. You do want to remember this reaction for the exam. Two carbons from acetyl-CoA are oxidized to CO2, which is a waste product. The free coenzyme A is recycled. And then the electrons from oxidation of carbon are put on to NAD+ and Q to make 3-NADH and a QH2. These are electron carriers that go on to give their electrons to the electron transport chain, as I'll talk about in the next topic. Now, it's necessary for these compounds to be able to give up their electrons to regenerate NAD+ and Q so that the citric acid cycle can continue. The ultimate electron acceptor is oxygen, so if oxygen is not present, then electrons will be stuck on the NADH and QH2, and the citric acid cycle will stop, because there's no NAD+ or Q available to make it go. So the citric acid cycle is dependent on the presence of molecular oxygen, or O2, even though O2 is not directly involved in any reaction in the cycle. And finally, the citric acid cycle also allows production of one GTP molecule, an ATP equivalent. Regulation of the pathway is similar to the other pathways that we have talked about. The cycle is promoted by the availability of substrates. Some of the enzymes are competitively inhibited by their products, and some enzymes are allosterically regulated. Now, a high ATP concentration means that the cell is low on available energy and the cycle is activated at this step here. I won't talk anywhere else in the course about calcium, but since it's on this figure, I'll just say that it is a signal that the cell should produce ATP, and so calcium activates two of the enzymes. And high concentrations of NADH and succinyl-CoA mean that the cycle should slow down. So you don't need to memorize the details of the regulation, just as long as you remember the principles of why the cycle should be activated or inhibited. And I want to talk briefly about the role of pyruvate and the citric acid cycle intermediates in biosynthesis. So these biosynthetic processes are represented like this on the master diagram, but keep in mind that this depiction is highly simplified. It's just supposed to be representative. Without going into great detail, the point I want to make is that some intermediates in glycolysis and the citric acid cycle are used to synthesize amino acids and other essential molecules. Some examples are shown on this figure. Now, don't worry about the details of these pathways or what compounds lead to what products. I just want you to recognize that some intermediates in the citric acid cycle may be used for biosynthesis of important molecules, such as amino acids and nitrogenous bases and heme. Similarly, many amino acids, when degraded, give rise to intermediates in glycolysis and the citric acid cycle. This means that proteins can be degraded to make ATP. 1 gram of protein gives about as much ATP as 1 gram of carbohydrate. So that's it for the citric acid cycle. In the next set of videos, I will describe how reduced electron carriers produced in glycolysis and the citric acid cycle are used to make ATP.